bring the meeting to order. Can I wish everybody good morning and welcome to the this meeting of the Combined Authority. Before going into the detail of the meeting, just the usual housekeeping points for me to mention. Can I remind everybody that all mobile phones should be turned to silent for the duration of the meeting? And to ensure that everyone in the chamber can hear the debate, can I please ask that members and those presenting reports please speak into the microphones provided, and because they both work best when you're close to them. And finally, as usual, the meeting will be filmed by officers from the Combined Authority and will be available on the Merseytravel Council YouTube channel later today. So, those are the housekeeping points. So, item one is apologies. Can I ask, are there any apologies for absence?
Chair, there are apologies from Mayor Anderson and Deputy Mayor Anna Burns here in substitution, and there are apologies from Councillor Moran and Councillor Kerr is here in substitution.
Okay, welcome to those colleagues. Item two, declarations of interest. Have any declarations of interest been received?
No received, Chair.
Okay, thank you. Item three, we have two sets of minutes to receive this morning. Can I first ask if the minutes of the Combined Authority meeting held on the 21st of August, attached as pages 1 to 6 of the agenda pack, are approved as a correct record of that meeting? Are they agreed? Thank you. And secondly, the minutes of the special meeting held on 2nd of September, attached as pages 7 to 10. Can I ask, are these agreed as a correct record of that meeting? Thank you. Robert, you want to bring something up?
Just one point, Chair, if I might. It's the foot of page 8. I won't have the temerity to.
Robert, just speak
yourself, because I wasn't at the meeting. But just at the bottom of page 8, about the rule on the left, the contents of the Devolution discussions, I'd like to raise that point in due course.
Robert, I just want to get the accuracy agreed first of all.
Yes,
this is a matter of arising, is it?
I think. It is.
Yeah. We don't take matters arising.
Okay, okay, so I'll defer my comment until later.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
So can we agree those minutes as an accurate record? Is that agreed? Thank you. Great. Right, so that takes us on to item four, the potential devolution of powers and funding to Liverpool City Region. And I'm going to ask Jeff Fitzgerald to step forward and update us with, I think you're going to do a brief presentation, Jeff. Thank you, Chair.
Good morning, everybody. This is just to update colleagues on where we're at in terms of the negotiations and various process issues associated with the potential devolution of powers and resources to the Liverpool City Region. Just a reminder in terms of the scale of the breadth of the proposals that we made to governments around 14 themes, which are set out on the slide. I won't go through those, Chair, in detail this morning, just as a reminder literally in terms of what we scoped in terms of the submission we made. Taking a step out from it, there were 38 submissions made from various authorities and groups of authorities across England. Specifically in the context of core cities, just for information and context, there was a clustering emerged around common themes around fiscal devolution, long-term transport funding, bus and train franchising, and devolution asks around that, skills funding and employment support type activities, business support, employment support, sorry, I mentioned housing and EU and health issues. And as you recall, they're adequately represented in the scope of the submission that we have made in the City Region as well. There's a big question mark on this, Chair, in terms of our assumption, because we haven't done all the detail around the 38 submissions, you'd be glad to know, because time just doesn't allow us to get to that level of detailed analysis. But we understand that the what I might refer to as Devo Max as opposed to Devo Min submissions have been made from the City Regions highlighted on the plan. Key issues to begin to focus our attention and our capacity around. I'll develop more of those in a second, but it's important actually to understand that there's a very limited government capacity to deal with the number of submissions that I've highlighted on that previous slide. And therefore, that places a premium on us needing to use the negotiation time and the contact time that we have with government as wisely as we can to secure the best possible negotiated deal that we can to bring that back to you around middle of November, as we talked about previously. Second bullet point is to highlight the fact that there are kind of ongoing timetables around the devolution discussions, and I think it will be an ongoing conversation. So the first is the spending review 2015. We expect that to be announced around about the end of November, as we've said previously. But there's obviously not far behind that, a bit like buses, will come the budget dialogue and conversation, and therefore potentially a further opportunity to continue the devolution discussions and secure further devolution from that. And then obviously there'll be the spending review next autumn. So I think fairly quickly this will get into a cyclical approach to seeing what we can actually be able to negotiate and announce on a range of different timetables looking forward. Third, we had a meeting with the Secretary of State, Greg Clark, about 10 days or so ago, and he was keen to emphasise to us the need to prioritise the proposals for the negotiations and the limited timescale we've got for negotiations. And we also need to identify and assess the financial implications so that we link together the outcome of the negotiations with very clear financial understandings of what that actually means from our point of view. And our job, of course, both as officials and as elected members, will be to optimise the amount of financial devolution to the city region by comparison with other parts of the country, and that's a very important contextual point to emphasise. And the fourth point I made, which I was very aware of this, last time I presented to you, the need to catch up with public awareness and stakeholder engagement around the context of the submission we made, where we're at in negotiation, what the process is, and all those kind of things. You might want to get that specifically when I finish the presentation. So to come to the prioritisation then, Chair, the our suggestion to you this morning is that the proposals that we've submitted and that you've endorsed previously, we've focused them down to economic development, transport, employment and skills, and what I refer to here as planning for growth or planning for development, which is, say, literally a line or two about each of these. We have talked about these in detail before. The logic to this suggestion is that these are the highest profile, highest impact areas also from an economic point of view, but also have significant financial implications and opportunities and potential for us. So therefore, trying to focus the resource that we've got, the time that we've got available to us, into the most significant areas of the submission that we've made. And these are the ones that were suggested to you this morning. So the economic development ones that are well documented, the investment fund, the focus on business support, culture, energy, the free trade zone, and the EU funding. We've spoken around those, each of those previously, Chair. Transport, bus and rail franchising, tunnel tolls, rolling stock and financial certainty around the proposals that were submitted from the transport. Employment and skills, looking to secure more focus on demand-led skills and things that work best from an economic point of view in terms of the workforce, both existing and future, in the city region. That's linked in terms to employability and making sure that there are better employability outcomes for the city region residents, both young and old, and probably moving to a co-commissioning model around that kind of set of issues. Looking to get much more outcomes and more volume in terms of apprenticeships and where those apprenticeships can end up in the economy, as we hope for more jobs to flow into the city region from all of the activities and conversations that we're focused on at the moment. And the planning for growth or planning for development is a combination of looking to get more emphasis on housing, very topical reference point given some of the national news this morning about the government's own housing targets for lifetime in the parliament, looking to a million new houses to be provided. We obviously want more than our fair share of those new houses to come into the city region from whatever source. But we need a spatial planning framework to be able to manage that effectively at a city regional level. We're looking for land commissions, both for housing and economic development activities, to make sure that the wider ownership of public land in the is actually used to its optimum in the city region, and at the moment, as we all know, we don't have control over that kind of issue. So having something like a land commission approach and format to it will allow us to do that. And there's one or two specifics around utilities and broadband that we'll be looking to obviously secure the best possible outcomes for us by comparison with other areas of the country. The last point, Chair, is around powers or resources. Each of those priorities and proposals that I've briefly outlined has either a power or a resource or a combined powers and resource issue associated with it. So what we've got to do now is get to the real detail of that as officials and distill the things that are very clearly a devolution power request and proposal as opposed to a devolution power resources issue, or as I say, sometimes a combination of those two things. And we obviously are looking to secure the best possible deal that we can from a fiscal neutrality point of view, which for us will mean that we are no worse off arising from this and hopefully a little bit better off in terms of certainty and control of money resources in the city region by comparison to the existing system and sets of arrangements, and also to make sure that fiscal neutrality as far as we're concerned means other parts of England will lose money. Whereas we don't want to lose any money, we'll be negotiating hard to ensure that that is the case. You might want to check back on some of these, obviously, in conversation in a second. Just in terms of some of the process issues that we're on with at the moment, we will need to provide evidence. It's not necessarily a thorough, comprehensive business case at the moment, but enough evidence to justify the devolution proposal in either the powers or resources context that was mentioned in a second ago. We have to assess the financial implications of those and our approach to that fiscal neutrality reference I was making a minute ago. And we need to articulate what better local delivery would look like in the future under these arrangements by comparison with the current, in terms of making money go further and generate more and better outcomes, and also how different forms of provision or activity and how services or activities are undertaken in the future by comparison with how they are at the moment makes a positive contribution and a positive difference to the city region, and also balances off the deal part from the government's point of view. So it's all of that kind of space around evidence and numbers in particular to back up the policy proposals that we've submitted already. And I touched on this a second ago, Chair. We recognise that we need to improve and speed up the level of engagement and communication to stakeholders and the wider public. And there's a framework that we're developing at the moment that we may become separately in a second around that whole issue, including the kind of media dimensions of that. And then just to round off, Chair, in terms of the next steps, the phased approach I mentioned before, we suggest that we adopt that in terms of being able to optimise the time and capacity we've got, focus on the most important priorities, the ones I've articulated in the presentation, and look to conclude the best possible deal around those negotiations around the middle of November, as we talked about previously. There's obviously a range of ongoing technical official level negotiations going on at the moment, and some of these will be iterative with the political negotiations that you will get involved in again with Greg Clark and colleagues at Greg Clark's over the next 8 weeks or so. We need to then twin track that with better communication engagement and information over that time scale so that the wider constituencies and partners involved in the city region understand where we are, where we're trying to get to, and are very clear about that. And the process will start very quickly. And as always, we'll come back to you at every given opportunity to touch base and update in terms of where we're at. And I will just emphasise one point, Chair, in case it's unclear from the presentation. None of this is agreed until all of it's agreed, and all of this comes back to the constituents' authorities to agree around about the middle of November. We're still anticipating that to
happen. Thanks very much for that, Chair. Before I bring members in, I just want to go back on a really important issue that you touched on around stakeholder awareness and public engagement. And with the combined authority being advised by Kenny Fraser on this, and Ben O'Brien from Kenny Fraser's come here today. So just with your permission, just like to give Ben a couple of minutes to talk about plans around public engagement, stakeholder involvement, etc. So Ben, do you want to just say a few words about that?
Chair, very briefly, as has been outlined in the presentation, things
things are developing quickly, and our role is to take that forward. Chair, I'm Chief Executive of Ken Fraser and Ben O'Brien. We're a Liverpool-based communications consultancy. We're very pleased to have been appointed to support taking the work forward. We're linking in with colleagues in Knowsley in the secretariat role in order to facilitate that. And really, given the timescales and the tasks in hand, to provide additional resources to be able to do that work to a high standard of the timescales that are required of us. So, in short, our role is to produce communications resources to support that better engagement with the public, with key stakeholder groups, including the business community and other stakeholder groups relevant to the key policy proposal areas that are being taken forward at this time and in advance of the CSR in the first instance. So we're here to provide additional resources. We're pulling together our plans to support doing that at a city region level and at borough level, as will be required by the work that officers are undertaking at this stage. And we're looking forward to taking that work forward from here on in as it takes shape. So thank you for inviting us along to introduce ourselves in the first instance.
Thanks, Ben. Right, so I'll open it up to members to make any comments, any questions of Jed around the process, where things are up to. Anybody want to say anything? Robbers?
Thank you. That's just dealing with my premature point on the minutes is, on page 8 of the pack, minute 39, I was asked at the last meeting. And there was some discussion at that time about the role of the left in the context of its opinions and then influences, particularly on the private sector. I just thought it useful, it's more just to contextualise those comments and how the left and I see it. I mean, first of all, I think we are the primary strategic point body for the city region within the left. And secondly, I think in the context of devolution itself, Greg Clark did make the comment that that was at the heart of any devolution discussions and resolution. That said, this is a collaborative discussion, a journey, and we have to work and will work closely with all our partners. But I just want to really emphasise that we believe we see ourselves as first of all equals amongst those private sector bodies and should be so regarded. I'd like to recall that. Moving on from that, I think this in the last few days, last week or so, there has been, I think, quite a remarkable unification of the private sector for this interest in this area. And no less than 10 or 11 bodies, including the Chambers of Commerce, Downtown Liverpool, the Division of Small Businesses, and so on, have come together, representing more than 250,000 employees with a single voice. And I think that is unprecedented in England. It's a great credit to the city region. It's a great credit to the unity and foresight of the private sector to come forward. And we see us elect through the combined authority as a conduit to express those opinions. So, Jed, they'll be very pleased to hear this morning your concentrated focus on specific items out of a long list of devolution asks. This is a long journey and we're segmenting it now in a particular focused way, which is appreciated, I'm sure, by the private sector. What they are very is keen to do, because we have a common voice working in this public-private sector partnership, is to ensure that there is not just communication, collaboration, listening, active participation in those areas of the economy within your agenda there, Chair. So around, for example, transport skills, economic development, planning, those areas are areas in which the private sector, this group of 11, who formed a policy group at the top, would like to engage. And they'll put forward individuals to work with your working group, in the local authority's working group, to take forward those particular issues. And it's that point I really want to make this morning. It isn't just about listening communication, it's about participation in issues that really do matter for this city region's economy and the businesses and employees within it.
Okay, Thanks, Robert. And I welcome that. And I've certainly attended a number of kind of business forums in the last few weeks. And I think we welcome the coming together of the business community with a focus on the engaging in the devolution agenda. So I think that's really helpful. So thanks for that, Robert.
If I might just build on that, Chair, just very briefly. Can we therefore hear promptly, which I mean the next 5 working days, the mechanisms of which the group here, the representative group, can in fact start to interface, if that's a convenient timetable? But it is that need to take it forward in that disciplined and clear fashion.
Yeah.
And I hear the words of great words, Chair, but just to have that reassurance that that mechanism for participation will be communicated and we can then build into it.
Yeah, I mean, I think. My response to that is yes, that does need to be a mechanism for that first use to be built into the discussions that would be taking place now with civil servants. But just Ben, just building on your presentation, I know that the business community are a key stakeholder in your plans for stakeholder engagement. So I would hope that there could be some kind of meeting of minds between the views coming out of that group that you just mentioned, Robert, and the work that Ken and Fraser are doing around this whole thing.
I'm sorry to bother it, Chair, it's important actually. It isn't just about communications. Now, in the working group to define the economic objectives within the areas that Jen has now outlined, it's as simple and stark as that actually. So it isn't a communication process, it's how that working group does reflect properly the private sector views as embodied by these 11 groups meeting this morning. Mandated me and asked me to make this point, and I fully endorse it.
And these are on this point.
Same point.
Yeah, go on, Andy.
I won't disagree in, but I think it's about the technical aspects of that. I mean, I think those engaged in communication experts in all our stakeholders, which is the business sector. So for the business sector, the left comments as it, we categorise that they want to be amazingly involved. Every stakeholder has got amazingly involved. We should be very mindful of that. Not paying anything to disrespect it, as has been said, and to agree to a lot of it, but it needs to be teased out over the next week or so. And it's not for this particular group to take to conduct this at this stage.
I think for me the key thing is. Oh, sorry, go on, Ian. Yeah.
Thanks, Chair. And alongside that, we also have to recognise, particularly the importance of prioritising. Our education community, colleges and faculty, has higher education. That's another critical part of this discussion. And their support and advice will be needed, I think, yes.
Okay. Can I ask Ben or Jed, do you want to say a little bit about how we can make sure that those particular stakeholders that we mentioned are genuinely part of this conversation going forward?
Thanks, Chair. I think there's at least two levels to this, other than the kind of wider comms issue, which has already been highlighted. We need to engage in a broad-based way with businesses collectively, as well as individually, and suggest. Is there this, the second the emergence of what Robert described in terms of the group of intent? So I think that will make that process a bit easier to manage. I think in terms of the technical stuff, it's maybe a conversation I have with Robert offline about how best to kind of link that together in terms of somebody on the officer side of the lab, for instance, maybe around that kind of issue. Business support is a great example of that. The lab player leads on business support, so it would be remiss of us not to engage in that expertise at that kind of level. I just need to teach through some of the practicalities of how that can actually work. So I think on both levels we can move those forward relatively. So,
I mean, I would suggest there's a conversation outside this meeting about how that is taken forward. But
I appreciate that, and I will get that. That's okay.
Okay, other points? Terry?
Thanks, Chair. I agree with what Robert says and the importance that the government is putting on the left and the private sector. Out of the 38 bids, Chair, did any of them not involve in the left and the private sector? What's the opinion about those that don't engage in the private sector?
What a great question, Jack. I couldn't tell you specifically on the 38, but I do pick up a lot of noise from colleagues elsewhere and the kind of conversations that we're party to nationally, that the left engagement is becoming very clunky, which is 38. I would suggest that notwithstanding the conversation we just had about how to engage more practically on the levels we've described, that we are very well placed here in City Region to be able to optimise the business engagement through LAC and the role of LAC in terms of where we are. One thing that is worth highlighting arising from Catherine's question is, as far as I know, we are the only LAC, we are the combined authority level LAC that has ceased at this level in the combined authorities, and that should go a long way to convince people, not just here, but in London, about the commitment that we have to work together in that kind of way. I would suggest maybe other areas want to follow suit on that kind of way, and that's a good way for them to catch up with what we're coming in.
Alan, you want to come in?
Just very quickly, Chair, from my position sitting on the LEP network and talking to other LEPs, it's very clear across the country, no place is the same. So if you went and talked to our friends in Hull, they're talking all out war between you know, local authorities, between LEPs, etc. And you go to other places where LEPs don't have a role, but it doesn't matter so much because they're further down the line. And some areas where LEPs are front and centre are actually writing the bids. So there's no one size fits all for this at all.
Yeah. Frank.
Sorry, Phil. Very briefly. I think what is unique about our city region, though, is all of those business organisations actually coming together as a collective. And I think that's something, a unique proposition that we should be informing government about. And just on Jed's point around evidence base, again, it's been mentioned about the educational institutions being involved in that training, education, and training aspect of the bid. And similarly, you know, we have great businesses who will be more than prepared to contribute free of charge to that evidence that we're looking to collate over the next few months. But we're all aware of the challenging timetable that's being put in place. So I think if those conversations through the local enterprise partnership can take place relatively quickly, then we may be able to get that expertise interacting with you and your officers, Jed, to give you that evidence-based solution that you require.
Yeah, I think it's a really good offer. I'm sure we'll take that up. Yeah, okay. Right, any other questions, comments? Jed, just before we sort of move on, can you just kind of say a little bit more about the asks, proposals that aren't in this first wave and what happens with them?
Yes, thank you, Chair. I did skip over that bit of the presentation, which I apologise. By virtue of the submission that we made, which is, as it were, this wide, we've been asked that we need to, in terms of our own capacity and the time scale we're working to focus on this set. That doesn't mean for one second that we're losing sight or dropping the other set. The point I was trying to make earlier about phased approaches, there will be a series of opportunities to be able to negotiate and to announce the outcome of negotiations into the future. So the first one I did put in the presentation was the kind of budget for next spring, and I confidently expect that we should certainly push for ongoing negotiations around the devolution with some staged announcements, staging poster announcements. First, which we spend a review around the middle and end of November, as we've said. Next one will be budget, that will be the autumn statement for next year, there might be something in between, and so on and so forth. So I think over the next maybe 3 years or so is the kind of view we should have around how far we go down the devolution journey and how much progress we can make on those issues. All of those issues still remain the same.
That's helpful to clarify. Okay, any other points anybody wants to raise? So, Jed, can I just ask, what decision are you looking for the Combined Authority to make this morning on this item?
I think in terms of the presentation and what the state's in play, it's firstly to sit down and note progress, because I think we have continued to make progress. And that's worth that reflected, really, so that from a public point of view, people understand that to be the case. The more operative points, I think, are the prioritisation process that I've outlined and get your endorsement to that, but with a recognition, of course, as I said before, that nothing is agreed until everything is agreed, and that is going to come back, obviously, at various meetings of the Combined Authority over the next few weeks as we get towards that middle of the time scale. And the third bit, which we opened up this morning in terms of the
Okay, so those are the points that we're being asked to give agreement to this morning. Can I ask, can we agree those those four elements? If they agree, okay, great. Thanks very much, Chair. Right, and obviously we'll have regular reports back at our future meetings on this item. So let's move on, colleagues, if we may, to item five, which is Transport for the North progress. And I'm going to ask Councillor Liam Robinson to give us an update on this, please, Liam.
Thank you. Thanks, Chair. This is just the latest periodic update on the progress of Transport for the North. But I thought it would be useful really to put it in presentational form rather than solely a report or a verbal update. Really to bring you up to speed with some of the progress that's been made so far, but also to plot on the horizon some of the things that will be happening in the next few months and weeks accordingly. Turning to Transport for the North, always useful to start with a quick recapitulation. Appreciate that members are fully aware of this, but obviously it's a process that the North's five city regions commenced with government back last year, really looking at how we could connect the North of England much better than we have in the past, really to facilitate economic growth and bring us together as one functioning economic area to support agglomeration of the North's economy. And the work is very detailed. It covers all modes of transport, road, rail, public, private. It covers things like smart ticketing. Increasingly, it covers international connectivity, which I'll talk about shortly. And crucially, it's not just about passenger transport, it's also about freight and the movements of goods and logistics accordingly. Very much it builds on the work that we commissioned as the North's five city regions, under the One North proposition a couple of years ago, which demonstrated that if we can get it right, it could be worth up to £109 billion in additional GVA to the North's economy as a key part of Britain's economy, so a key part of that economic rebalancing. In terms of the latest update, back in the summer, George Osborne in his budget made a number of announcements about Transport for the North. Most significantly is that government want to establish the body as a statutory body with statutory duties. And for the next 3 years, it will get £30 million of additional funding, really to support its setup as an organisation and to pay for its running costs and some of the project work that it needs to embark upon. As part of becoming a statutory body, governments have called for it to have an interim chief executive and executive team to get it set up and facilitated accordingly, and with an independent chair to the organisation by the end of this year. Very much as part of its work of updating the North of England's transport strategy, which can inform the budget which we will have from government in the spring of next year. One of the early things that the government wants us to focus on is the introduction of Oyster-style smart integrated ticketing across the North of England, and that's something I will come on to in a moment. But also to continue to push ahead with some of the detailed project work on a Trans-North rail network, what some dub HS3, which for technical reasons I won't use, but I think is the moniker that's likely to stick with it, but also about focusing on a Trans-Pennine road tunnel, particularly underneath the Peak District between Manchester and Sheffield. Very much focusing on a prioritised list of schemes that we can put towards government to hopefully get some financial assistance from them in the budget of next year. In terms of the governance, as part of becoming a statutory body, the government's actually looking into what is the relevant legislative vehicle. That could be an amendment to existing legislation, it could be a totally new bill, it could be piggybacking onto a transport bill that could be coming through Parliament in the next few months. So that's being investigated at this moment in time. Not just how we can create Transport for the North, but I would expect would also potentially lead to the creation of other sub-national transport bodies. I could imagine there being a Transport for East Anglia, one for the West Country, and so on and so on. Obviously working closely with governments on that, but we expect Transport for the North to be fully up and running as an organisation by 2017. Added to that, we're obviously facilitating a variety of the asks that governments have made of us. One of the key elements is with regards to TFN. Ourselves and colleagues right across the North are embarking on the process of appointing an independent chair for the organisation, as well as an interim chief executive to actually set up the organisation. As part of this, we're also facilitating it with a number of officers from our city region and other city regions, really to do a lot of that detailed work that is required. And I think it's a useful opportunity really to put on record my thanks to all the detailed work that our officers from Merseytravel and the wider city region have been doing in terms of making the right arguments and the right cases for us to part of that body. And we expect a permanent chief executive to be in place round about late into next year with a full officer team to support them. Probably also worth mentioning whilst we're just talking about governance as well, that the government has asked us to expand the geographic representation of transport for the north, so it's no longer just the city regions, it's also all of the county areas as well. And it's great to see Councillor Terry O'Neill here from Warrington, because obviously he represents all the Cheshire authorities in the body as well. So what about the actual detailed work? What are those transport projects we're doing the work upon? Well, I think the most significant one, the most exciting one, really does refer to the rail work stream. I mentioned previously, before, one of the kind of key elements is about the development of a Trans-North rail network, a new high-speed rail network for the north of England, linking all of our cities and surrounding areas accordingly. As key part of the Liverpool City Regions Ask, we strongly believe, and we're strongly making the case for, a new high-speed line from Liverpool going east towards Manchester, the first stage of that HS3 idea, but crucially for us, with a full connection onto the HS2 network. We strongly believe that that new piece of railway line can actually fulfil our high-speed requirements as a city region, east-west, but also north-south as well. And a lot of the detailed work that we're embedded in as part of Transport for the North is beginning to show that actually, to make that a reality, it will require a new piece of railway line. Upgrading what is already there would actually be costly and practically very difficult to do. So we continue to make that argument for that new high-speed line, and we're hopeful that we will get that accordingly, because that's a very key demand for us city region as part of it. Obviously it's not just about trains. In terms of the highways network, there's three initial key strategic projects that we're working on. One being a new Trans-Pennine tunnel linking Manchester and Sheffield. I think for any of us that have ever had to drive to Sheffield, or for that matter, if anyone from the city region has ever had to send freight by road across to South Yorkshire and the North East Midlands, we know how snarled up it can become when we get to the other side of Manchester. So it's really important for the North Road connectivity that that starts to become addressed. Likewise, the northwest quadrant of the M60 and the extension of smart motorway technology on that key part of the North Road network. What we do find, as you all know, and actually a lot of congestion on that part of the road network knocked back onto the M62 and actually comes west back towards Warrington. So that's a key part of the buckle in the belt, if you like, that needs to be addressed. Equally as well, a new focus on North Trans-Pennine routes. One of the things that we find is that there's a disproportionate amount of road traffic in the north has to go via the M62, whereas if we're linking up to other parts of the north, particularly the northeast, there could be a good opportunity with enhancing some of the routes from places like Cumbria across to the northeast, actually to give a better road capacity so we can send things north than east and vice versa, rather than everything having to go through the M62. Obviously, smart ticketing is something that government is very keen for us to focus upon. One of the things that we're doing as part of that is really looking at how our walrus card, the smart card that has been launched in the city region, which by usage is the second largest smart card area in the country after London's Oyster, how that can be a key part of smart ticketing. Let's not throw the baby out with the bathwater, let's overlay new northern strategy onto what we've got in our city region and other city regions as well. Added to smart ticketing, another key work stream of Transport for the North is international connectivity. This is really about focusing how the North of England connects on a global scale. How do we maximise the opportunities of our airports right across the North and actually increase the breadth of destinations that we've got from airlines to airports across the North of England? A real key part of Transport for the North, but our city region particularly, is around freight. As I mentioned beforehand, it's not solely about passenger traffic and the movement of people. Movement of goods and freight is absolutely vital, particularly when we think about how important the superport concept is to our city region and the growth of our economy locally. As you well know, the city region was poised to launch the development of a city region freight and logistics strategy. Very pleased to say that in doing that work, actually, we were ahead of the game. So now the fact that Transport for the North is looking at a northern freight and logistics strategy, we as the Liverpool City Region's combined authority are leading on all of that work. That's vital for our city region, particularly of how important logistics are to us. And that work will really not just look at how freight and logistics moves around the north already and what current demand there is, but we'll also focus on forecast demand of how freight and logistics movement is going to grow in the future, so that we can inform what the transport infrastructure requirements are for the movement of freight. Particularly vital when we think about how we need to make sure we get the best multimodal answers to our whole superport, particularly the Port of Liverpool extension. Added to that, as well as the kind of sub-national elements of Transport for the North, there is a local strategic connectivity workstream, really focusing about how do we connect city regions internally in a much better sense, particularly increasing cross-city region journeys. One of the key areas that we're investigating and focusing on is the reopening of the Wapping Tunnel, which is the railway tunnel that is currently not used underneath the city centre of Liverpool, looking at how we connect the Mersey Rail network with the Northern Rail network, and potentially giving us the opportunity of direct trains from both of those networks, so you could have, for argument's sake, trains from places like Southport, West Kirby, going to places like Wigan, Warrington, St Helens directly. So that's a key thing that we're focusing on from a local angle as well. Obviously, it all boils down to money, and Transport for the North is making a number of very strong submissions to government about what we want to see out, particularly in the first instance, the comprehensive spending review, but then in the future, next year's budget. One of the key asks is about a long-term funding horizon, committed funding all the way up to 2021 in the multi-million pound area, probably into the hundreds of millions of pounds, to do the detailed project work we need to do to make these schemes shovel-ready and something that we can actually get on and crack on with. Equally, as part of that, it has to be new money. We can't have a situation by which previously committed funding, things like local authority majors, local growth fund money, are double counted in the process. If we're going to maximise the opportunity of Transport for the North, we need to have new money over and above what is already being committed. So, in sum, looking towards the future, Transport for the North is going to be submitting shortly a further interim report highlighting the progress it has made, but actually focusing on the kind of things we want to see coming out of the comprehensive spending review, with then a focus on a new full report in the spring of next year to inform next year's national budget. Obviously, we'll continue to do some of the very detailed work we've been embedded on as part of drawing up those detailed options and those detailed projects and transport infrastructure that we want to see and we know we need to have for our city region. And equally, we will continue to support the establishment of Transport for the North as a statutory body. And throughout the process, we'll continue to keep members fully updated where we're up to. So I hope that's useful, and if anyone's got any questions or comments, I'm more than happy to take those.
Liam, thank you. Thank you very much for that comprehensive update. Okay. Members, questions, comments? Andy?
Fantastic. Excellent presentation. Any comments about what Lord Newman